This video is brought to you by Incogni. There's no shortage of potential solutions to the world's critical need for renewable energy storage, but there is a shortage of accessible and cheap resources to use for those solutions. With the limitations of materials like lithium and vanadium in mind, it's logical to look for alternatives that are basically limitless. How about regular run-of-the-mill salt?
Just a little sodium chloride.
Actually, dude, it's salt.
That's what I said, sodium chloride.
Redox flow batteries, or RFBs, can exploit the abundance of elements like sodium and iron. One US company already has saltwater batteries ready to go, with at least two others developing iron flow variations built effectively to run on rust. They promise to last longer and be far cheaper than the competition. So what happens if we go with the flow? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. Before we get into why regular old salt may be a winning ingredient to our energy storage needs, it's important to understand what it's up against. Two major problems hold back renewable energy: intermittency and curtailment. You could sum it up as being an issue of feast or famine. We can't rely on the forces of sunshine and wind 24/7, and at the same time, without proper infrastructure, we lose out on a lot of power when supply overtakes demand. To complete the renewable energy transition and cheapen energy for everybody, we need long-term storage for excess power. And that's where grid storage systems come into play. Lithium-ion batteries are a popular, powerful option, but they can be unstable, both in the cost of materials and on a chemical level. It's just not feasible to rely on lithium-ion as the primary storage option. By comparison, flow batteries are a lot cheaper, and some chemistries can lower or even eliminate the risk of fire. Ultimately, each approach serves its own purpose. Generally speaking, lithium-ion batteries are light and compact. Flow batteries tend to be bulky. That said, they're inherently scalable in ways that lithium ion isn't. Now, we've covered flow batteries before, both vanadium and bromine, but if RFB sounds more like a music genre than a battery to you, here's a quick rundown of how they work. A redox flow battery, or RFB, takes the form of two tanks, a catholyte and an analyte. Now, these tanks surround a chamber that's split down the middle, and the liquid electrolytes flow from the tanks into either side. The process of reduction oxidation, also known as redox, sends the electrons from the catholyte to the analyte when the battery is being charged, and the reverse happens when the battery is being discharged. When it comes to the design, a major edge that RFBs offer is the direct control over their energy and storage capacities. As long as you have enough electrolyte, you can theoretically increase the storage as much as you want by increasing the size of the tanks. And if you increase the number of electrode cell stacks, or the middle bit between the tanks, that means more power. There's an overwhelming number of variations in RFB electrolyte, but vanadium is currently the gold, or maybe the rainbow, standard. It has the capacity to exist in multiple oxidation states, which allows vanadium RFBs to function with fewer electroactive components. As a result of how the redox reaction works out, VRFBs last longer relative to other chemistries. For a more detailed look at the science behind this, you can check out our previous video on it. Here's where vanadium, like just pretty much everything else, runs into trouble, and that's costs. The element is notorious for its price volatility. It's one of the most used materials in the industrial sector, like alloying steel, so vanadium's beauty and flexibility does not come cheap. According to a 2016 study, the chemicals needed for VRFBs can represent nearly 60% of the overall cost of the system. Newer research shows that the prices have only gone up. A 2021 study by the University of California, Irvine, found that electrolyte using vanadium pentoxide accounted for a whopping 80% of a VRFB's total cost. Now, here's where things get salty. US-based company Infinity Turbine has proposed its Salgenex flow battery as an answer to this problem. It functions the same way as any other RFB does, except one of its tanks contains chlorine gas dissolved into a proprietary electrolyte, and the other is full of nothing but good old sodium chloride and water. In the company's words, it's just add water, but with salt. Now, the source could be the ocean, geothermal brine, power plant cooling ponds. You get the idea. Now, before I get into what makes this salt battery so special, I'd like to thank Incogni for sponsoring this portion of today's video. Now, I've mentioned this before, but I signed up for a newsletter from a small online retailer, and after I did, I saw a major increase in the number of promotional emails that I was receiving from companies that I've never heard of. And that's because they sold my information to a data broker. And I'm sure you've experienced it too. Incogni can help you with this. We have the right to request that data brokers delete our information, but it takes a lot of time and effort. I signed up for Incogni, gave them the legal right to work on my behalf, and then just sat back and relaxed. You'll see updates in your account for which data brokers they've sent legal requests to, and which ones have complied. It couldn't be easier. I've been letting Incogni stay on top of this for me for quite a while now, and I'm very happy with the results. I've noticed a difference. If you want to take back some of the control around who has access to your personal information, give Incogni a try. The first 100 people to use the code UNDECIDED, the link below, will get 60% off Incogni. Thanks to Incogni and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to a very salty battery. Now, as you might expect, taking advantage of the ubiquity of salt water means saving a lot of money. A 2022 US Department of Energy study estimates that depending on the acid and grade of the vanadium used, VRFB electrolytes can cost between $105 and $180 per kilowatt hour. Meanwhile, Salgenex claims that the cost of its battery's electrolytes is less than $5 per kilowatt hour. As for how the Salgenex battery stacks up to existing products in the market, Infinity Turbine claims that it's less expensive to acquire and faster to deploy than the Tesla Megapack, but notes that the Megapack involves less moving parts. But the Salgenex battery does have a simplified configuration relative to other flow batteries. And unlike most types of RFPs, the Salgenex battery has no membrane separating the electrode. Instead, they take advantage of the natural immiscibility of the electrolyte's fluids to keep the components separated. Think oil and water. On its website, Infinity Turbine argues that the Salgenex's lack of a membrane saves huge upfront purchase costs, maintenance, and consumable expenses. And the idea does hold water. That's because the batteries typically rely on ion-permeable membranes to limit what's known as crossover.
It's a crossover!
Which can tank the battery's capacity. And these membranes also play a big role in the voltage and energy efficiency of the RFB. Striking this delicate balance is pricey. And to put these costs into perspective, a 2014 study found that the ion exchange membranes were undoubtedly an expensive component of the flow batteries, with their calculated price coming out to several times more than the battery's plates and electrodes. They estimated the future cost of the membranes would drop significantly, but the cost range was still much higher relative to the rest of the battery's parts. Economics aren't the only thing that Salgenex's battery has going for it. According to their website, they list saltwater flow batteries' round-trip efficiency at 91%, which is impressive and on par with many lithium-ion battery chemistries. The company also advertises an energy density of 125.7 watt-hours per liter, but it is important to note that's markedly less than the average energy density of a lithium-based battery, regardless of what kind. Figures from the U.S. National Renewable Energy Laboratory, or NREL, between lithium iron phosphate, lithium nickel cobalt aluminum, and lithium nickel manganese cobalt, you're looking at energy densities from at least 210 watt-hours per liter to as high as 600 watt-hours per liter. However, Infinity Turbine has unique applications in store. Now, in March, the company revealed its ongoing development of a desalination system that uses the Salgenex battery. With this tech, the same movement of ions between the electrodes that generates power would also produce fresh water at the same time. Now, this has big implications for places like cruise ship liners, cargo ships, and military bases. And just this month, the company announced that the Salgenex redox process can also be adapted to produce graphene. For example, the fiberglass and carbon fiber fabrication industry could essentially use a Salgenex battery as both a source of power and a graphene-making machine. Infinity Turbine claims the savings would be serious, cutting the cost of graphene from an average of $100 to $400 a gram to $1.25 a gram. But take that with a grain of salt, because that still has to be proven out. Another American company is also experimenting with saltwater RFBs, and if you've seen our previous video on floating solar, it's doing so in a very familiar place. In February, ESS, an iron salt battery manufacturer, announced its collaboration with the Turlock Irrigation District, a California-based utility. As part of Project Nexus, the district's initiative is to install solar panels over the state's irrigation canals. ESS's batteries will provide long-duration energy storage. The plan is to finish construction in 2024. ESS will also be installing iron flow battery facilities in Sacramento, California, as part of a collaboration with the Sacramento Municipal Utility District starting this year. So what makes ESS's energy warehouse battery so special? Well, like Salgenex's battery, it operates with a saltwater electrolyte, but it's using iron salts in the water instead, which is particularly advantageous because iron is at least two orders of magnitude more bountiful than vanadium. We're talking about a crustal abundance of about 52,000 parts per million compared to 138. On top of that, vanadium is more difficult to substitute, and remember, we really like it for our steel production. Now, in contrast, the ferrous chloride that's present in the energy warehouse electrolyte can actually be produced from steelmaking waste. The chemical cocktail in iron flow batteries has the potential to make use of the dregs that's left behind what steelmakers call pickle liquor, which sounds like something you'd be drinking while playing pickleball. Now, so ironically, what makes vanadium expensive and difficult to obtain is exactly why iron can be so easy to use in RFBs. Where vanadium electrolyte can represent as much as 80% of a flow battery's costs, iron electrolyte makes up only about 4%. Now, iron flow batteries are also non-toxic, which is obviously very helpful in light of the high toxicity of vanadium oxides. Now, ESS claims that its energy warehouse reduces or eliminates the need for hazardous permits for transport, HVAC, fire suppression, and end-of-life disposal planning. Now, this is consistent with the conveniences of other flow batteries that use water-based electrolytes like zinc bromine. And just like other RFBs, iron salts and saltwater batteries allow for a higher degree of safety in comparison with lithium ion. You don't have to worry about thermal runaway when a battery just isn't flammable in the first place. As for longevity, both the Energy Warehouse and Salgenex boast a life expectancy of about 25 years. The Energy Warehouse also knocks other batteries out of the park in terms of cycle life. And broadly speaking, the number of cycles a lithium-ion battery can last is usually limited to just over 1,000 to 2,000 cycles. Zinc-bromine batteries can last up to about 5,000 cycles, and ESS holds that Energy Warehouse can last for over 20,000 cycles. That's truly the battery that just keeps on going. And duration is another leg up that ESS claims over lithium-ion, which translates into lower costs. The company estimates that past the 4-hour storage duration mark, its iron flow batteries remain cheaper than lithium-ion all the way up to their maximum of 12 hours. And when you take all of this into account, you can see why a lot of people are excited about the potential for salt and iron in RFBs. Readily available materials that are cheap and safe, which could help answer the growing demand for energy storage. And not to get salty here, but when someone says to me, just go fill in your favorite tech here, like just go nuclear, just go solar, just go whatever it is, it drives me a little nuts. There's not one energy storage or generation option to rule them all here. We need a wide array of options to satisfy all the different use cases that we have. And this salty one may be a great one to add to the mix, even if it's just for flavor. So what do you think? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still To Be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video, and a welcome to new Supporter Plus member, Dry Frog. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.